We have two presenters today who are going to come on screen here in just a few seconds. The first is Dr. Brian L. Steed. He is a retired U.S. Army Lieutenant Colonel whose service includes service as a foreign area officer in the Middle East and a personal exchange officer with the Jordanian Armed Forces. He is also an associate professor of military history at the U.S. Army Command and General Staff College and a senior fellow at the National at Narrative Strategies. He holds a PhD from the University of Missouri, Kansas City in political science and history. In 2014, he published a book titled Bees and Spiders, Applied Cultural Awareness and the Art of Cross-Cultural Influence, which includes his lessons learned about serving in an Arab army. George Thompson is a historian, writer, and lecturer on the First World War. He currently serves as the coordinator of the North American group of the T.E. Lawrence Society and is a member of the Academic Advisory Committee for the National World War I Museum Memorial. He has over 30 years of experience as a college professor and administrator. Prior to this, he was a U.S. Army officer between 1965 and 1972. His current focus is writing, lecturing, and developing public programs in the life and legacy of T.E. Lawrence. So without further ado, ladies and gentlemen, I will hand it over to Dr. Steed and Mr. Thompson.
Thank you, James, and thank you, Laura, and thank you to the World War I Museum and Memorial. It's always a pleasure to work with them, and I'm grateful for the opportunity to work with George and to listen to him. So T.E. Lawrence is a romantic figure. He's a romantic figure for a lot of reasons, not least is the film by David Lean that most people are kind of familiar with him from. But I would argue he is also a romantic figure just in what he captures, this idea of exploration and understanding another culture. That's kind of how I first romanticized a little bit about him. So from 2005 to 2007, or I'm sorry, 2008, I had the privilege of being a Jordanian army officer. And in that role, I learned that the Jordanian army draws a lot of its culture, tradition, and heritage back to the Bedouin tribes that fought alongside Lawrence of Arabia in what is sometimes called the North Arab Revolt, and certainly the Great Arab Revolt writ large. And of course, the Hashemite Kingdom of Jordan in its modern form is descended from Abdullah, one of the sons of Sheriff Hussein. Now, I also had in my role as a Jordanian army officer, the unit with which I worked had responsibility for observing all of the frontier border of Jordan, literally every single kilometer. So because of that, I got to drive every kilometer. And these pictures show part of the time we spent on the Saudi border going through the exact terrain that Lawrence goes through on his famous march up to and then ultimately into Aqaba. And the lower left image is a bridge of the Hejaz Railway. I got to admit that when we drove across the Hejaz Railway and came to it, I was asking the Jordanian soldiers with me, is this a Hejaz Railway that Lawrence attacked? And anyway, they really didn't understand why I was geeking out about it so much, but I was, because it was really pretty cool. Now I want to get a little bit at Lawrence's story and that romantic aspect of it. So I want to go back to the Great Game, which was this struggle between the Russian Empire, which for more than 100 years or nearly 100 years is advancing east into Central Asia and at one point all the way to the Pacific Ocean. And at the same time, you have the British Empire that's trying to protect India. India is considered the jewel in the British crown. And it's considered that because the king or queen of England is the king or queen of England, but they were the emperor or empress of India. So the whole idea of a British empire takes on that name because of India. And so India is the driving aspect of this. And a great many of the in protecting India, the British were doing so through what they refer to as a forward policy. The idea was to go outside of India to protect India. But yet many of the maps that existed in these mid-1800s to late 1800s had a lot of blank spots. And so they sent these British British people, I'm going to call them, because they were sort of part military officer, they were part diplomat, they were part scholar, they were part writers. They were these really fascinating individuals who then would go out and try to make contact with these famous caravan trading cities that they had heard about from people like Marco Polo and the things that they had written hundreds of years before, but the British did not officially know about them or know what existed between Moscow and Calcutta and then later Delhi. And so these are the people, because they, either books were written about them or they themselves published their journals of their travels, Lawrence would have grown up reading about these really fascinating and romantic characters. And then closer to Lawrence's own day, he had some other individuals. No longer was there a great game, because that kind of ends around 1907 to 1909. But now the British are still exploring what I refer to as the unexplored places. So the places that are blank spots on the map, which in many cases are Africa, or they're in the Middle East, particularly Arabia and Mesopotamia. And so some of these names are quite famous, people like Kitchener, Percy Cox, Gertrude Bell, and George will talk about Mark Sykes and Ronald Storrs and mention their names that figure prominently in this story. Now, when we talk about the British Empire in the Middle East during World War I, it's important to realize that the British Empire interacts with the Middle East from three separate capitals. The obvious one is London, right? Because that's the capital of the British Empire. But the others are a little bit less obvious. Secondly is Delhi, which is where the Raj, or the government of India, that's its capital at this point in history. And then the third is Cairo, where the High Commissioner of Egypt is a player. Now, that capital takes on a greater role when Kitchener becomes the High Commissioner of Egypt. And then when Kitchener goes from that position to London to head the war office during the early years of World War I, then because of his deference to his former workmates down in Cairo, Cairo gets elevated even more. So really these three capitals interact. And what's interesting is, even though there are individuals like Mark Sykes and Percy Cox and Gertrude Bell and T.E. Lawrence who do speak Arabic, have studied Arabic or have studied Middle Eastern history, are familiar with the cultures, most of the people who work in London or Delhi or Cairo have no idea about a whole lot that deals with the Middle East. They don't really understand the religion of Islam very much. They don't understand this role and the influence of the caliph, which we'll talk about in just a moment. And they don't really get the relationships that exist between the Turks, the Arabs, and the Europeans. And they understand that there's friction between the Arabs and Turks, but in many cases, they think that means the Arabs would prefer the Europeans rather than understanding how this dynamic actually plays out. And so I talked about the role of the caliph. We often refer to this title or this position as the Ottoman Sultan Caliph. And he gets this hyphenated title because in one part, he's the Ottoman Sultan or the ruler of the Ottoman Empire. But on the other part, he's the Caliph, or in Arabic, the Khalifa, meaning he's the successor of the Prophet Muhammad for all Islam. Now, Mehmet V, who is the caliph throughout most of World War I, is very much a titular figure. He's just a figurehead. His power has been usurped by individuals who we refer to as Young Turks, and it's the Committee for Union and Progress, often called the CUP, that really are running the day-to-day aspects of the empire. But Mehmet V is still the sultan. And he's still the caliph for all Muslims. So the empire in 1914 looks like this. It has shrunk quite a bit, but it still has these six very influential cities from a cultural and historical standpoint: Constantinople, Baghdad, Damascus, and Mecca, which are all caliphal capital cities, but it also has Jerusalem and Medina, which have religious significance for Islam and for the Abrahamic religions in general. There's also this dynamic within the Islamic or within the Ottoman Empire where they're trying to modernize. And that includes railroads, the Hejaz rail line, which, once again, if you've seen the movie Lawrence of Arabia and what we'll talk about today in Lawrence's conduct as an irregular warfare leader, figures quite prominently. And this exists from Constantinople down to Mecca with the idea of aiding the Hajj and Hajj pilgrims in getting to that location. I said Mecca, it's down to Medina. And from Medina, you have to go by more traditional transport into Mecca itself. Now in 1914, shortly after entering the war on the side of the Central Powers, Mehmet V will be encouraged by the Germans to declare jihad or holy war against those who are opponents to the Central Powers. Now, some critics of Mehmet V will refer to this as the jihad manufactured in Germany. And there's a little truth to that, but it's interesting how influential or non-influential this is. It isn't as significant as some, certainly the Germans wanted it to be, but in some cases it is an irritant for the British Empire. And one of the reasons for that is a fact that is often forgotten. If you think of the major empires involved in World War I and ask yourself which of those empires has the largest Muslim population, the answer is the British Empire by a large margin. They are the largest Islamic empire, if you will. That's actually an inaccurate way to characterize them, but they are the largest empire with respect to Muslims. Now, as we talked about, or as I mentioned earlier, there are multiple British capitals interacting, and there are multiple tribes and key leaders present in Arabia. So you have Ibn Rashid, and often that group is referred to as the Rashidis. You have Ibn Saud, and of course we refer to them quite often as the Saudis. And then you have Sheriff Hussein, who holds a position given to him by the Ottomans as the Sheriff of the holy sites of Mecca and Medina. The Rashidis are allied with the Ottomans. Ibn Saud is allied with the British, but through the government of India. So he works with people like Gertrude Bell and Percy Cox and others. Whereas Sheriff Hussein is allied with the British, but through the High Commissioner in Egypt, which is why Lawrence works with him. And as the war begins in 1914, the British will invade Mesopotamia, will capture Basra. The Turks will invade the Caucasus, and this is where they'll put most of their effort throughout the war. Then in 1915, the British will continue their attack in Mesopotamia. They'll land at Gallipoli. Both of these will go horribly wrong. The Turks will attack the Sinai, attack the Suez Canal. That doesn't go well for them. And they attack from the Sahara toward the Nile, also not going well. And in 1916, we have the Ottomans again attack toward the Suez Canal. They get stopped. The British respond, not going very well. And it's this year when the Arab revolt begins. And this is where I want to hand this back to George so that he can talk about Lawrence himself.
Thank you. Brian. Thomas Edward Lawrence arrived in Cairo in December 14, 1914. He was a newly commissioned second lieutenant who was assigned to the Army's Military Intelligence Department. Although Lawrence had no prior military experience, he did possess what was needed, which was an extensive knowledge of the Middle East. From 1914 up until the fall of 1916, Lawrence prepared maps, wrote intelligence reports, assembled information on the Ottoman army, and participated in two special missions, one to Greece and the other to Mesopotamia. By early 1916, his effectiveness led him to be promoted to the rank of captain. In October 1916, all this would change. Lawrence accompanied Ronald Storrs on a fact-finding mission to the port of Jeddah, which is located on the Red Sea in Arabia. They were to meet Cyril Wilson, the British liaison to Emir Hussein, and his son Abdullah. This was Lawrence's first visit to Arabia, and his job was to gather information on the revolt, its leaders, their needs, and geographic information. By that October, the Arab revolt, which had begun in June, was showing signs of collapse. The question that was debated among British leaders was whether to reinforce it with British troops or to let it fail. Lawrence's insights, especially regarding Arab morale and leadership, would help them make their decision. He spent a week in what is called the Hejaz at three locations. While there, he rode his first camel in order to travel inland to meet Hussein's son named Faisal, who commanded the largest Arab warband. Their meeting would change both of them and link them to a common cause for the next 5 years. What he was looking for was which of Hussein's four sons would be the best one to lead the Arabs in the field. He found what he was looking for in Faisal. He also found that the Arabs were badly organized, undermanned, ill-equipped, and on the verge of collapse. In contrast to some who wanted to send British troops or to let them fail, he recommended that they send only advisors, along with, food, weapons, and gold. He advocated the Arabs' objective should be to contain the Turks by raiding and disrupting the Hejaz railway. This would make effective use of the Arabs' traditional skill as a raider. At the same time, the British should create a regular Arab army from their Turkish prisoners who were Arabs and would be loyal to Emir Hussein. The political and military chiefs liked his advice. In November 1916, he was transferred from the Army's Military Intelligence Department to the Arab Bureau, a political arm of the Foreign Office that was directed by his pre-war mentor, David Hogarth, and was appointed the British liaison officer to Faisal and the Arab Army. Lawrence's return to Arabia in November can be seen as five different phases that start in 1917 and end in the fall of 1918. Each phase occurred at different locations with different time spans and different objectives. The first phase was in January 1917. Lawrence, with Faisal and his Arab warriors, shifted their base from Yenbo by land and sea to the port of Wedge. The reason for the move was to place them beyond the range of the Turkish army at Medina and to position them to be able to attack the Hejaz railway. The second phase was from February to May 1917. This would be his most formative period. It saw him travel inland to learn the art of attacking the rail line and to spend time with the Arabs. But most of all, it was the period when he formulated his theory on irregular warfare. The next phase, from May through July 1917, was the period that transformed him into the legend of Lawrence of Arabia. He, along with six Arab leaders and 17 men, departed from Wedge on May 9th. This group made an 8-week, 620-mile journey that ended with the capture of the port of Aqaba on July 6th. By the time they reached Aqaba, they had recruited hundreds of tribesmen, which allowed them to overwhelm the Turkish garrison. Lawrence then traveled to Cairo to report the capture of Aqaba. While there, he met the new British commander, Sir Edmund Allenby, and in this meeting, he outlined future operations for the Arabs in Palestine and Syria. On August 5th, in recognition for his achievement, he was promoted to major. And on the 20th, he published in the Arab Bulletin his famous 27 articles. In this piece, which is now a classic, he listed how a Westerner could effectively interact with the Arabs. The fourth phase was from July through December 1917. He is now operating out of the British Arab base at Aqaba and was starting to develop a new one at Azraq. His locations and activities were dictated by a new role as a strategic advisor. We find him in Cairo, Jeddah, even Jerusalem for Allenby's entry into it, and on several treks out of Aqaba to attack the Ottoman railway and bridges. His most famous expedition was the one that tried to destroy a bridge over the Yarmouk River in support of Allenby's 1917 offensive. The fifth and final phase was from January to October 1918. His year began with the creation of his own war band of over 90 men. He was on the move between Aqaba and Azraq. He raided the Hejaz Railway, organized and moved supplies, and participated in planning operations at British headquarters. It also saw him direct two battles. His victory in January at Talif led to his promotion to lieutenant colonel, and at Deraa in September, his initiatives contributed to the capture of Damascus. His entry into the Syrian capital brought his military war to an end, and by mid-October, he was back in Britain and poised to enter a new phase of his life, a political campaign for Arab self-determination. Today's presentation has identified Lawrence as an apostle of irregular warfare. This label is appropriate for two reasons. The first is the evidence of his exploits and successes that has been described. The second is the legacy he has left in his numerous writings that describe the principles of irregular warfare. Why is he identified as an apostle? Well, the reason is found in his memoir, where on more than one occasion he described his role as preaching. He presents himself as one who moves among the Arabs as a messenger that delivers or spreads an idea and a cause. This role is less understood as compared to the view of him as a raider, but a closer reading reveals him as an advocate for what we call today asymmetrical warfare. Lawrence is unique because he not only practiced what he preached, he wrote it down as a set of principles that describes this unorthodox form of warfare. You can find his concepts in his memoir, Seven Pillars of Wisdom, his secret dispatches published in the Arab Bulletin, his 27 articles, and especially in his 1920 essay, The Evolution of a Revolt. What all of these do, which had not been done before, is to set down the principles of this form of warfare. However, Lawrence's career as an advocate of this type of combat has been in dispute. Some argue he overstated his role, or what he did was mere banditry. This is not a minor criticism, because it was his Arabian campaign that gave him his fame and identified him as Lawrence of Arabia. This dispute should not surprise us. Even at the time, there were doubts among officers in the army as to the military value of Arab irregulars. To some of his colleagues, Lawrence, although seen as courageous, was viewed as a semi-rogue agent, not as a soldier. But to Sir Edmund Allenby, whose judgment matters most, saw Lawrence as a brilliant tactician with a genius for leadership. What Allenby's observation meant in practice was not just organizing and leading raids. It meant handling the Arabs so as to mold them into a useful political and military instrument. Lawrence had to not only convince his British colleagues of what should be the next course of action, he had to also convince the Arabs. The reason for his success can be traced to two reasons. The first was he was particularly gifted in his ability to get along with the Arabs. Nuri al-Said at the time said, and I quote, "It was possible for Lawrence to understand at first instance the Arabs better than any other Briton," end of quote. Unlike him, most British officers had difficulty working with the Arabs because of their different values and because they were fighting a military war. What is central to understanding Lawrence and the Arabs is they were not fighting a military war, but rather they were fighting a political one. Rather than being a military war, it was an insurrection or political revolt, whose end was larger than any military operation. For this reason, the unconventional approach defined by Lawrence would ensure he was and would be misunderstood by those who believed in conventional military operations. It is to Allenby's credit that he recognized this and saw a role for the Arabs in his military campaign. The Arabs could guard his flank, be a distraction to the Turks, draw off Turkish troops, and disrupt their supply system. These objectives would require that the Arab army be redeployed from Wedj to Aqaba, where they would be under the supervision of a member of Allenby's staff. In the field, Lawrence was a keen observer. He used his observations of the terrain and the characteristics of the Turks and the Arabs to formulate his theory of warfare. In early 1917, he learned how to travel and survive in Arabia. He recognized that water sources from wells could be used as bases. If known and controlled, they allowed Arab war bands to cover vast distances. This gave them a mobility that the Turks did not have. Plus, the Arabs knew the terrain that they were operating in. Lawrence called this principle geographical intuition. Lawrence knew success would depend on the number of camels the raiders had at their disposal. This meant that these animals had to be carefully selected and after use be sent to pasture for rest following an operation. The same was true of men. He knew that Arab irregulars were civilians first and could not be pressed beyond certain points, especially the mixing of tribes because of their dislike or distrust of each other. Lawrence realized that the Arab warrior was at his core a sniper, who when used well could impose a threat on the Turks rather than to attack them at a point of their strength. If the Arabs could force the Ottomans to be on the defensive, then they had the initiative to suddenly appear at a favorable location and attack. In Lawrence's essay, The Evolution of a Revolt, he stated that irregular warfare is predicated on three elements that he identified as the algebraical element of things, biological element of lives, and the psychological element of ideas. The algebraical element is the area to be controlled, or in military terms, the force to space ratio. Lawrence recognized that this element could be calculated in terms of the number of men required to control a territory. And this control could be delivered in two ways, as fixed or mobile deployments. If the Turks chose the fixed and the Arabs the mobile, it meant that the Arabs did not have to present themselves as targets. And if the Turks chose to be immobile, they could not effectively control the territory, which meant it would be in the possession of the Arabs. As mobile warriors, Lawrence saw them more as, I quote, an influence, an idea, a thing intangible, without front or back, drifting about like a gas against which a regular soldier would be powerless, end of quote. The biological element was a force's breaking point due to casualties and exhaustion. When applied to the Bedouins, he realized they had two fears: facing weapons such as artillery, machine guns, and aircraft, and the taking of a large number of casualties. These fears affected their morale and motivation, which meant that in the field, the Arabs must avoid large-scale frontal attacks against strong enemy positions. This element dictated that the Arabs concentrate for a brief moment to strike a point where there were only a few Turks, and then quickly disappear. To wage this type of warfare required perfect intelligence, which was accomplished through scouting. The third element was the psychological, which Lawrence ranked as the most important. What it implied was that he and the Arab leaders had to arrange the minds of their men in order to motivate them and to ensure they were prepared to act as individuals. But it did not stop there, because it also implied influencing the enemy's mind and the minds of the tribes who were supporting the rebels. And because Lawrence conceived the war as a political struggle, the minds of others, or as he wrote, the circle beyond circle, was important to attend to, because he believed that more than half the battle passed in the back. His strategic goal was to force the Turks into a passive defense. This would then force them to overextend themselves in order to anticipate potential Arab attacks. Once this was accomplished, the Arabs would have the initiative, which allowed their mobility and range to concentrate and attack the weak points in the Turkish defense. This is why he liked camels and eventually air power for his operations. The animal was suited to the desert environment, which gave the Arabs the mobility and the stamina that was required. Lawrence compared this form of maneuver warfare to naval operations. He described his war bands as camel raiding parties that cruise along the enemy's cultivation frontier and then retreat back into the desert. He described their tactics as tip and run, not pushes but strokes, whose objective was to use the smallest force in the quickest time at the farthest place. In his method, the individual rather than the group would determine the power of an attack. He said, and I quote, "Our idea should be to make our battle a series of single combats," end of quote. The Arabs' tactics could not be complex because the men needed to go into action as independent individuals. They were expected to use their intelligence in response to the situation. Excuse me. In the attack, their method was to deliver in relays because it was expected to be a sequence of isolated individual actions required initiative, endurance, and enthusiasm. Discipline in the traditional military terms did not apply because it would submerge the warrior's individuality, which was essential to fostering motivation. In the end, every man had to be self-motivated, self-contained, and self-sufficient. And as a provocative advocate, he concluded that irregular warfare is far more intellectual than a bayonet charge. I now pass you back to Brian, who will talk about Lawrence's legacy in the 20th century.
Okay, welcome back. Let's make sure I can share the right screen. Okay, so I want to address, like George said, where Lawrence sort of fits. At the Command and General Staff College, we teach students, every student, a variety of military theorists. So the term military theorist is somebody who posits theories, and I know some social scientists might argue that whether or not they're technically always theories, but either theories or philosophies regarding how war ought to be fought or how it has been fought successfully in the past. So let's talk about where Lawrence fits in this whole deal. Okay, so first, George even said this word. We often talk about symmetrical or asymmetrical, or we use the word symmetry or asymmetry. And almost every person today tries to use asymmetry. So I'm going to try to confuse this a little bit. So you have symmetrical war. And what I mean by symmetrical war is this is war where essentially both participants are fighting the same game. So they're playing the same game, and they might be playing by the same rules with the same size teams, or they might not. They might be playing it slightly different. So to date myself a little bit, for the American football fans, this would be like when the West Coast offense showed up in the National Football League many, many years ago. That was an asymmetry to a symmetrical competition. Everybody still had the same number of players, etc. Okay. So that's what symmetrical means. And you can have symmetrical symmetry. Everybody's playing at the same game, same way. Or you can have symmetrical asymmetry. We're playing the same game, but we're playing it different ways. The other way is an asymmetrical approach, meaning essentially we're playing different games. And now we might be playing different games with the same sorts of resources. So when we talk about great power competition, you might have two great powers who have essentially the same types of resources and the same amounts of resources. And even though they're playing different games, they bring similar tools, toys, et cetera, to the competition. Therefore, it's asymmetrical symmetry. But we might also have opponents who aren't the same with respect to resources, and they're not playing the same game. So they're not playing the same game, and they're playing it radically differently. So we talk about asymmetrical symmetry might be somebody playing American football and their opponent is playing soccer, or what the rest of the world calls football, since we have an international audience. If those two guys are playing on the same thing, roughly a soccer pitch and American football field are pretty much the same, that's asymmetrical symmetry. Different games, roughly the same way. Asymmetrical asymmetry would be somebody's playing American football and the other guys are playing golf. And it just so happens that one of the fairways crosses the football field, kind of thing. Okay. Now, you ought to be asking, why does this even matter? Most military theorists, certainly all of the ones that we teach the officers at the U.S. Army Command and General Staff College, function in this symmetrical world. A couple of them deal in symmetrical symmetry. They're talking about folks who are playing the same game the same way. Most of the theorists, though, are adding some twist to how that plays a game. And I would argue this includes people like Mao Zedong. This includes individuals like the Vietnamese General Giap or Ho Chi Minh, right? So they're not necessarily playing a different game, although you might argue that Ho and Giap are playing a different game. Okay, so that one's a little questionable. But where does T.E. Lawrence fit in this aspect? So based off of what George has just told you, I would argue that T.E. Lawrence is relatively unique, not entirely, because I'll give you another option, but he covers both sides. He recognizes that there is a way, like he's a British Army officer, and he has to make sure that the Arab irregulars can function alongside the British Army, which means that there has to be some symmetrical component to what they're doing. I would argue that more specifically, this is also this algebraic element that George talked about. That's within this symmetry. It's understanding the soccer pitch. It's understanding how many players can play and all that sort of thing, to keep running with the sports metaphor. But on the other part, Lawrence also talks about that biological element and the psychological element. And both of those, I would argue, fit in this asymmetrical world. So Lawrence is once again, somewhat unique in this. I would offer that another individual who's talked about this is a guy named Abu Bakr Naji. He wrote a treatise that was published in 2004 called The Management of Savagery. And I actually have an entire presentation I gave that's on YouTube. I did it with the Dole Institute on the management of savagery. So if you want more details, you can go look that up. But the idea here is that modern groups, whether that's Al-Qaeda, ISIS, those sorts of groups, recognize that they can't compete, they can't play the same game and win. And so therefore, they're going to have to play a different game. And yet they still have a theory of how to win in that different game, much as Lawrence had to deal with that they couldn't compete with the Ottomans the same way. They were never going to be as strong as the Ottomans, so they had to win in their weakness. And this gets at how they imagined doing that. So I'm going to jump forward in time from Lawrence, and I'm going to deal with Iraq in 2003. So a couple of years back, I was working on a documentary project. And as I was writing the script, I was doing research for it. And I was emphasizing, or the part that we were supposed to be talking about, is the initial attack into Iraq in 2003, what we refer to as the March up to Baghdad. And I wanted to use this, I guess you can call it an acronym, that the Army uses. It's the commander's role in the operations process. And it's the understand, visualize, describe, direct, lead, assess. And what I realized as I was going through this process, that at no point and at no level did the United States actually understand the Iraqis. They didn't understand Saddam Hussein at his strategic level. They didn't understand how he was arraying forces at the operational level. And they didn't understand why the Iraqis were fighting the way they were fighting at the tactical level. And yet, this was the most successful military operation in history. An army went farther, faster, and overthrew an opposing government in less time than had ever been done before. So how could you get that result without any understanding? And this is what led me to what I'm going to talk about next. Now, I expect somebody's going to say, oh, this wasn't really successful, but I'm just talking about the toppling of Saddam Hussein, not anything that came after that. So that's what I mean by success without understanding. The lack of understanding then plays out later. But okay, so I'm going to go back and tell a brief war story. About 30 years ago, 29 years ago, I think right now, I was a second lieutenant. And I was at the Scout Platoon Leaders Course. And part of what we were being trained to do was to be able to do an analysis of bridges to determine how much they could carry, like can we drive a tank across this bridge, but also what it would take to destroy that bridge if we had to do so. So when we were doing the bridge demolition training, we had an engineer non-commissioned officer who was conducting the training. And so there were these certain formulas, the calculations, you'd do measurements, you'd look at what the bridge was made out of, and you'd measure how big the abutments were. And then you'd get little calculations, and depending on the explosive you wanted to use or had available to use, it would tell you how many pounds of that explosive you would need to destroy that bridge. And I remember doing this one calculation, and I came up with a number. I can't remember what it is now, but I will say it was 10.8 pounds. And I went up to the engineer NCO, and he's like, yes, Lieutenant, what is your answer? And I'm like, 10.8. And he's wrong. And I'm like, wrong? And he's like, I can't remember what he said. For this sake, he's like, it's 15. And I'm like, what do you mean 15? And I'm like, I wasn't a genius in math. There's a reason I'm a historian. But I'm like, hey, like I did the calculation, and here's what the number showed me. Why is it 15? And he said, because, Lieutenant, you forgot to add the variable P. I was like, what? It's like there's no variable P in this equation that you gave me. And he said, that's the variable P for plenty. And so in demolitions, you always add P so that you don't have to go up and blow up something twice. I'm like, okay. So I learned that key lesson about the variable P. So what I'm talking about now is the importance of the variable P with respect to understanding. When you have a lot of plenty, and plenty is relative to your opponent, but when you have a lot of plenty, you don't need a lot of understanding. Okay, so there's an inverse relation between the two. So in Iraqi Freedom, we had the ability to throw attack helicopter battalions against the enemy over and over again. You know, they destroyed one deep attack. It didn't matter. We could launch another one a couple of nights later. And so when you have a lot of plenty, and I give a couple of World War II examples where we parked 39 aircraft carriers off of Okinawa. When you can park 39 aircraft carriers off of an island, you don't really have to understand your enemy very much. But when you don't have a lot of resources, when your plenty is low, when your variable P is low, then inversely, your variable U needs to be high. And this is the genius of Lawrence. Lawrence recognized this, and this is also true of most irregular warriors, that he was never going to be able to match the Ottomans, and therefore he had to overcome that numerical disparity by an inverse amount of understanding of the opponent, where they are, how many there are, how he can isolate them, how are they going to fight, what's going to cause them to run or break. And this was Lawrence's genius. Now, for those of you guys who are wondering, wait, well, why have things gone poorly for the last 20 years? I would argue that it's because we purposely chose not to put a lot of plenty in Iraq or Afghanistan after the fall of the Taliban or Saddam Hussein. And we also did not increase radically at the institutional level, our understanding of our opponents. Anyway, so, and when you have low P and low U, then that's not good. Okay, so this is why I think Lawrence is particularly important, because he offers this opportunity to recognize how you do both, how you function in a symmetrical world and in an asymmetrical world, and how you can use, in his case, the asymmetrical to your advantage. I would suggest and submit that our opponents in the world today, and by our, I mean opponents of the West, whether that's Western Europe or the United States, are, whether they're great powers or they're non-state actors, are seeking asymmetrical means. Nobody is trying to play the game that the West is good at. They're trying to play another game, and most of them are trying to play them with asymmetrical means. They are trying to do asymmetrical asymmetry. And this is why Lawrence has some value today. So I'm gonna end there and then turn this back to, I guess I turn it back to Laura for any questions that we have.
That is exactly right. And welcome. I am Laura Vogt, curator of education, and it is a delight to have you all here with us for the Q&A portion. Brian, George, thank you both very much. Just a quick reminder, if you are joining us on Zoom, take a moment and put your questions into that Q&A section. If you are joining us on Facebook Live, you can just add your questions in to the comment section as well. And also, greetings to the very global audience that we have joining us. So whether or not it is your morning or your evening, thank you so much for being here. First question is from Susan Vincent. Why does the US and UK military high command not ensure that many of the army officers in the Middle East or Afghanistan, I apologize, Susan, I'm hopefully gonna be reading this correctly, not take a key point of those articles, which is to learn the local language, especially Arabic. Brian, how's your Arabic?
It has gotten worse since I left the Middle East. But because Arabs are very complimentary of any attempt, I do have a student right now who's from the UAE, and he says I speak perfect Arabic. So we'll go with his praise, and but it's probably not accurate.
Well, and you are actually an instructor for the United States military. Is there an emphasis on learning languages when you're placing soldiers, sailors, and the like, service members into particular places? What are the challenges of learning languages, or particularly learning Arabic?
Okay, so this is a great opportunity for me to say that I am not speaking on behalf of the United States Army Command and General Staff College or any part of the United States government. I am speaking only for myself. That said, one of the things to understand is languages are hard, and Arabic is very difficult. And that's true of most languages. Anybody who's spoken a language, I've known a few people who learn them really easily, and I don't like them very much. Arabic was very, very hard for me. So it requires a tremendous amount of resources in time. Even if it doesn't cost a lot of money, it takes a lot of time to commit people to learn language. And I think one of the challenges that the military of any country has to decide is how does it invest its resources? And I tell my students when we teach history, it's a fascinating thing. So in between World War I and World War II, the Royal Navy spent almost no time or money on, I mean, they did develop what they called ASDIC, but they've spent almost no time training on how to fight submarines. Now, you would think that anti-submarine warfare would have been important given how important submarines were in World War I. And but the truth this gets out is that a service or any organization, and militaries are an organization, will only do one of two things, either what their boss orders them to do, or what their culture values. And our bosses for a while in the US military did order guys to study languages, but because of the costs and in time in particular, as we have withdrawn from countries like Afghanistan and Iraq, we have placed less and less emphasis on language because our culture doesn't value it. The military culture values shooting guns and blowing things up. Like that's what it values and that's what it trains. So it is a challenge, and it's something that everybody like me argues for all the time, that we need to spend a lot more time on language.
Did Lawrence come up with his own military ideas, or did he have some singularly, or were those ideas of irregular warfare influenced by others, other authors, other leaders that he might have been studying? And that question is thanks to Joseph Ryan.
Well, that's really a fascinating question. I think that, you know, the key element there is basically Lawrence, if we think about him arriving in 1916, he was 28 years old. In my estimation, that's fairly young and formative. So he has he's a well-educated individual, given his Oxford University training and degree, and self-read in things that interest him. Now, some of the biographies point to that important meeting going in 1916 in October to meet Cyril Wilson and Abdullah. Aboard, besides Ronald Storrs, is a man named Al-Mazri, who was a Ottoman officer who is now going over to the opposite side. And it is traced to him that in the conversations, or it's suggested on the way down from Suez to Jeddah, that he picked up on Mazri's idea of raiding the Hejaz Railway. So that's pretty important from the point of view of maybe one source, but we can't say that he's a plagiarist by any means, because Lawrence really is observing in the field and he's adding to it. Now, when we read his 1920 essay, Evolution of Revolt, he drags out all the great thinkers, Napoleon, Foch, von Clausewitz, and his particular hero is Marshall Saxe. So I don't know, you know, that's one of those interesting what ifs. Did he read all those individuals? But he certainly is effective in quoting them in 1920. So somehow he's absorbed that information. Whether that was in his youth, which probably is the only place that can be traced to. So it's a happy marriage of his university education with his very perceptive observations of the Arabs and the tribes and so forth. He was already by that time aware of the misgivings of what Brian covered were the failed offensives in 1915, 1916 with Gallipoli, and then eventually the surrender at Kut. So he was already looking for alternatives than this headbanging that was going on at the time.
And Jason Sexton, hopefully that answers your questions as well. Dorian Blagg also mentioned talking about T.E. Lawrence referencing a lot of other people within his writing, that the U.S. Army Marine Corps Counterinsurgency Field Manual of 2007 mentions a lot of T.E. Lawrence. So clearly there has been some influence on the modern military as well. And there are a couple of questions about legacy. First, from Lorraine Tinsley, Dr. Steed, could you comment on the attitudes among the Jordanian military today towards the legacy of Lawrence and the Bedouins during the Arab Revolt?
Okay, so I'm going to tell another story that's, I don't know how funny it is, but first of all, it still does infuse, like those tribes still infuse the Jordanian military. The Jordanian military has their own dialect of Arabic that's a little bit different than your average Jordanian. So they use different phrases and different pronunciations. That comes from this sort of Bedouin East Bank sort of connection. I remember when I went to the town of Man, I went there with the U.S. Embassy my first year in Jordan. And then later I told some Jordanian army officers that I'd gone to Man, and they asked me, oh, well, what did you think of it? And you know, I made some comments, and there's like, oh, all the guys there are smugglers and whatever. So if you think about how Omar Sharif refers to the Hawitat tribe and in the movie Lawrence of Arabia, that was still the way that they expressed, because the Hawitats are still a dominant tribe in Ma'an, Jordan, even today. And they're still sort of characterized in that same way. I thought it was hilarious. I thought it was rather funny, but, so they draw a lot of their tradition back to that, but I would argue the British officer that has more impact or a greater impact on the British or on the Jordanian army is John Bagot Glubb. And he comes over to Jordan in the 1930s. He'll arrive in Iraq in 1920, but he ends up, so he's a more dominant figure. A lot of the Jordanians sort of downplay Jordan or Lawrence rather, and act as if he was not as significant as Faisal and as the Arab players were.
On that same train of legacy, Richard asks, is there evidence that the Taliban had any awareness of or implemented any of Lawrence's principles for irregular war?
Yeah, I'm assuming that's coming back to me. So
it absolutely would be. You are correct.
So one of the things that I think is important with any military theorist is like there's a debate about whether Karl von Clausewitz read Sun Tzu, for example. And there's aspects of what he writes that at times seems like he might have, but sometimes, and anyway, we don't know whether he did. Lawrence captures some truisms regarding war. And if you're a weak power that's intending to defeat a strong power, and you're going to do so by, in an asymmetrical way, using your weak asymmetry to your advantage, then there are a set of tools and behaviors that are, I don't want to say that they're like super limited, but they're finite. And Lawrence captures a lot of those. I think like the guy who writes Management of Savagery, like you can read him and you can hear Lawrence talking, but I don't know that he got that from Lawrence. I know that you can go online and find out what Osama bin Laden had in his house in Abbottabad, Pakistan. I would not be shocked if he had seven pillars of wisdom. So I think a great many people are aware of that. And by people, I mean a great many, whether they're Taliban, Al-Qaeda, ISIS, those kinds of cats. I think they're aware of what Lawrence did. But they might also be drawing similar lessons from other theorists as well.
Gentlemen, thank you so much. Would you be willing to stay? We've got a couple more questions. Would you be willing to stay a little bit longer?
Yes.
Fantastic. Absolutely.
Ah, wonderful. For those of you who are able to stay along with us and continue some of the conversation, we would love for you to do so. For those of you who need to leave at the appointed hour, thank you so much for being here. Again, George Thompson, Brian Steed, a pleasure to have you both. If you want to see some more and participate with some of our other good friends at the Command and General Staff College, you might be fans of John Kuhn or Scott Stevenson. Again, I would say take a look at our website, www.theworldwar.org/symposia, and you can take a look at how you can participate either online or on site for the symposium happening in Kansas City, October 29th and 30th. And as always, pay attention to the wonderful partnerships that are happening and the 2022 events on behalf of the National World War I Museum and Memorial, James, and on behalf of the T.E. Lawrence Society. Thank you all so much for being with us in this live cast. And stay along if you want to listen to a little bit more Q&A. And if you are joining us after the fact, thanks for taking the time to use some of your free time to learn a little bit more about the enduring impact of World War I. All right, Brian, George, let's take a look at a few more questions. Parker Reidbaum asks, the Germans developed their own stormtrooper tactics and used them to a degree of success on the Western Front. Is there any evidence that the Germans shared those lessons with their Ottoman allies in the Middle East campaign against the British and the Arab rebels?
It's an interesting question. You know, maybe we ought to say what is the explain what the stormtrooper tactics are. The Germans perfected this, and there's always a modern debate over did the French figure it out first, or did Captain Rohr figure it out? Well, that's fascinating, but nevertheless, the Germans actually, of course, put that into practice, and to a lesser degree, the French and British, of course, imitated the method. So the idea of the stormtrooper tactic was very highly well-trained, motivated men who were individualistic, interestingly enough. It does kind of go back to the notion of asymmetrical, symmetrical, because most of the armies on the Western Front were more lockstep doctrinaire. And so when they were locked in this trench embrace, the stormtrooper came to fore probably in 1915, mid to late 1915. And the Germans had figured out that if they had these small groups of highly motivated men with a combination of different weapon systems, flamethrowers, grenades, carbines, pistols, and clubs, and so forth, that they could slip into the opponent's line, particularly the French, disrupt their communications and try to drive on in and isolate an area. And so that methodology was perfected by the Germans, and that's where that stormtrooper form comes. I think somewhere in my reading, that notion of an elite kind of set of infantrymen made its way into the Ottoman army, but it doesn't have the cachet or the impression that you have with the Germans, such as Ernst Jünger and the others. So it's an interesting question. It's something that I would kind of look at, but I think there's probably an inclination that there was sharing. Brian, do you have any thoughts on that?
Well, I think I would be shocked, because I think the German view of the Turks was not that they were of a sufficient discipline and training level to adopt what they believed to be a really, really difficult thing. Stormtrooper tactics were at the apex of their difficulty curve. And then the other challenge, of course, that goes in, they train it, they work on it, they perfect it, they implement it, and they don't really have as good a distribution means to get those lessons learned, you know, because you're talking at opposite corners of the continent. So I think it would have just been practically very difficult to get there, even if they thought that the Turks were able to do what they were doing. That's my gut, is I just don't know that they felt the Turks were up to it.
Well, and the Turks were fighting basically a very defensive war. You know, after Allenby's arrival, and even up and through the 1915, 1916, everything is a defensive position. And of course, with that comes counterattacks. But the stormtrooper is designed to be a sharp point of the spear, an offensive weapon. We know that the Austrians imitated it to some degree, but again, probably with a lesser degree of thoroughness. And Brian's right, you know, it was a problem with dissemination. You know, once they found this, what they thought was to be the recipe, then it did require some complexity and specially trained men to do that. And then once they were spent, that was it. But it's an offensive tool.
What you all are speaking to alludes to Susan Stein's question from earlier in the conversation. Did the Turkish Ottoman experience in the strategy that you described today influence how Atatürk, Mustafa Kemal's, his strategy in its war of independence?
Wow.
And that's going to be a fabulous stump the speaker question, Susan, if you have done it.
I think it's stumping me, but I'll wing at it. Well, again, if we think about Atatürk, the Ottomans are really crumbling around the edges. And he comes to fore there in 1919, 1920, and so forth. And the Turks are absolutely under assault. Between, I think the most insidious are the Greeks and the Italians, and I don't mean to offend them, but they're really trying to snatch a lot of territory from the heartland of Anatolia. And so it is, so he has to really restructure and reorganize the Turkish army. And whether it has the luxury of sophisticated tactics, I don't know. Brian, your thoughts?
Well, I think it goes back to how he perceives his relationship to his opponent. Although he recognizes that he's weaker, I think Atatürk is trying to play the same game. He's not trying to play the irregular game. he's trying to win with a regular army, which he acknowledges at certain points is too weak. And so he's trying to gather it, strengthen it, train it, develop it, arm it, equip it, all that stuff, and get it ready for the battles he's going to fight. I don't know, to fight in a regular war, you have to change your mindset. And one of the things I think for most uniformed officers, and I think this is true of Mustafa Kemal, an irregular war is sort of a shameful step down. It's like not what you prefer to do. And this was in part, like, even if you think about the American Revolution, George Washington and others did not want to do the irregular fight because they looked down on it as this isn't what real soldiers do. And I think Ataturk was very much a real soldier in his mind.
You know, to add on to that, I think Ryan's got a major point there in that regard. But, you know, what's different from in 1919, 1920 is that Ataturk is fighting what Lawrence saw as most interesting, and that's a political war, because his country has collapsed in terms of the empire, and it's on life support. And so even though he probably conducted it as a regular symmetrical warfare, but he probably had one eye on politics at the same time, because he had to reclaim the territory, but also build a political ideology that people would embrace, which really lends him to a little bit of a sympathy with Lawrence.
In that same sector of Lawrence and sympathy within different cultures, could either of you speak to, it is a combination of two questions here. Does anyone know how good T.E. Lawrence's Arabic was? And also, would either of you know when the Seven Pillars was translated into Arabic?
Well, I don't know. That's a really interesting question about whether it has been translated. I mean, that's such an obvious question, but I honestly don't know the answer to that. It has been translated in different languages. I think that, what was that first part of, besides the Seven Pillars?
Sure, how good was Lawrence's Arabic?
Well, that's always an issue of dispute. Lawrence obviously knew it well enough to operate with Faisal in those various councils. So it must have been very effective.
So Lawrence gets hit for his Arabic not being super great. Like, I don't think, like, for example, John Bagot Glubb, who's sort of more from my perspective, that, like, he could speak Bedouin poetry, which is like the biggest praise for your Arabic level. If you can understand Bedouin poetry and you can do your own Bedouin poetry, then, like, that's arguably the highest Arabic you're going to get. Glubb could do that. I don't think Lawrence could, but Lawrence could do, like, he was functionally literate with Arabic. And by literate, I mean communicative. Like, it isn't just that he could function with Faisal and others. He could function with average Arab soldiers and average Bedouin. Because having dealt with that, like, I could talk to educated people with my Arabic, but if I talk to a cab driver on the street, like, a lot of times they would just look at me. Like, I had a friend in Jordan. I said something that was, they refer to it as Fosal, which is modern standard Arabic. And he's like, oh, what do you want to do, this or this? And I said, as you like, or in Fosa, it's kama tarid. And he just broke out laughing. and I'm like, what? And he's like, nobody talks like that. And I'm like, well, how do you guys say it? And it's zema bidik. That's Jordanian Arabic, which sounds nothing like kama tarid. So, And I regularly did stuff like that in Arabic because I was taught one level of Arabic. And if you watch Al Jazeera and those sorts of things, they talk that level of Arabic because it's relatively consistent across the Arab world, but only educated people could talk that way. Lawrence was able to both deal with leaders who almost certainly spoke educated Arabic, but he could also deal with common Arab and Bedouin soldiers. So his Arabic, all I can say, it was better than mine. So I will never criticize his Arabic.
Yeah, I would. You just have to take a look at the time that Lawrence is really on his own. He doesn't have a guide. He doesn't have a helper. So in that critique of the phases, you know, in February to May, you know, he's out there in Wadi As with Abdullah. And so he's there for several days. So he has to be speaking some form of language that they can understand. And then just think of that long journey from Wedge to the capture of Aqaba from May until July. He doesn't have any helper there, so he has to use some form of communication that works. So, you know, we don't know in depth what his training is, if he did have lessons at one point, but he must have had some skill with the language to be functional over those great spans of time.
Talking a bit more specifically about Lawrence, his knowledge and his writings, and this is one that I think we can all have a little bit more life experience that we can reflect on recently about major global pandemics. Hmm. Did T.E. Lawrence, to either of your knowledge, write about the influenza pandemic around World War I, which certainly caused far too many deaths between 1918 and 1919? That question comes to us from Tony McCready in Glasgow, Scotland. Thanks, Tony.
I don't think, I've not seen anything, and I've been studying very recently his post-war life. And his father passed from influenza, which may have been the result of the Spanish flu. I'm not sure in that respect. But really, there's nothing in many of his comments about that episode, which, you know, that's interesting. You'd think perhaps he would have. You don't find it in his letters. And he was wrote great volumes of letters from his childhood on up, almost to his death. And you don't find him reflecting on the influenza pandemic.
This question, Brian, is for you. Could you expand on the differences between the Cairo and India offices in supporting the Arab revolt? That comes to us from Gregory Thomas.
Yeah, unmuting. Okay, that is a great question. So you get some interesting personalities. So Percy Cox, Gertrude Bell at one point or another works with almost every element of the British, but she will, I think by the end of the war, she's working more on the Mesopotamia side and interacting with the Saud issues and what's going on in Mesopotamia and also what's going on in Saudi Arabia. So one of the things that is interesting in India is focused almost entirely, like everybody in the British Isle is concerned about trade routes and being able to get things from wherever in the world to India and back again. Like that the entire British Empire thinks about that. But India is almost fanatical about that's everything they do is because they think somebody is trying to attack India or they're trying to protect India. So from their perspective, they want the Arabian Peninsula to be secure. They don't care by whom. So it's all about effectiveness, and it has nothing to do with ideology. It has nothing to do with belief system. And of course, I'm being a little harsh on the India office, and I am kind of harsh on the India office from that perspective, because I don't think they really thought that through. But they were just looking at it on, okay, who's going to create a stable Arabian Peninsula? So they put, and they're like, okay, Ibn Saud and his guys seem to be quite capable of doing that. They didn't take into account, even though they knew that Ibn Saud was allied with a group that were referred to then as the Ikhwan. If we call them the Ikhwan today, that will create some mistake, because the Ikhwan today are the Muslim Brotherhood, and the Ikhwan that worked with Ibn Saud are not the same guys, but they are much more in line with how we would think of as sort of Salafi, Takfiri, jihadi kind of guys, that they were opposed to, certainly opposed to the West. And once Saud got control of the Arabian Peninsula, they wanted to attack everybody. They wanted to attack Baghdad. They wanted to attack Amman, Jordan. They wanted to attack elsewhere. And the British Empire basically forced Ibn Saud to get control of them. So it's an intriguing thing that Cairo's focus was on the Suez Canal specifically, and they thought they could work with Hussein and that would work. And they also were, and it's kind of odd, I don't know why, but I think that they were a little bit bigger picture because they were also looking at Sharif Hussein as an ideal replacement of a caliph for the Ottoman Sultan caliph. And it seemed to make logical sense. He is the designated guardian of the holy places. That seems to be logical that he could be a replacement caliph. What is so odd to us today and almost seems like comical would be the notion that a European Christian power could designate who the head of Islam would be. Like today we laugh at that notion, but they were actually rather serious about it. And so that's part of what was driving these conflicting motivations of who's supporting whom. And by the time we get to 1923-24, I can't quite remember. I think it's 23-24 when Saud and Hussein are fighting each other. And the British at that point are annoyed with Hussein because they feel like he's not sufficiently grateful and he continues to demand more. And so they stop supporting him. So I think all of these get into this complexity about what they each care about. And what's odd is they should be all caring about the same things, but the government of India is a special side all by itself in terms of their just audit, their fixation on protecting India and thinking that everybody was trying to attack India. I hope that answers that or addresses it anyway.
It at least was a tip of the iceberg in what is a very complex question. Brian, George, thank you both so very much for a delightful and insightful conversation about Lawrence of Arabia and irregular warfare. We really appreciate your time and your expertise and for sharing it with us in such an accessible way. And for those of you who have stayed with us again from across the globe, thank you so much. It really is an honor to share time with you and to be a part of a community together. Thank you all. We look forward to seeing you at future events. And if you want to find out more about those, again, check it out on our website, theworldwar.org. And until then, you can also take a look on our YouTube channel where you might find more conversations from both of our speakers today. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Laura.
Thank you.